Ahora, bien, bien. Sí, ahora sí.
Okay, so I think we can continue. So we will continue with the last presentation of this workshop. So thank you for being here still for the last presentation. And yeah, probably, I mean, I should present myself because I don't know who is online, but probably the people who is here in the room, or unless they know me. I mean, I am professor here in the department, in the institute, and my field of expertise is completely different to what we have seen here. It's accelerator physics, accelerator physics. So, and the idea of this this presentation is, I mean, now we are at the end of the workshop. We had a very nice comprehensive discussion on many aspects of neutron stars, from observational aspects, including gravitational waves, electromagnetic, the theory to understand the structure. But maybe there is still a small piece of information which is missing, which is what we can do from the labs on Earth, okay? It means using accelerators. And maybe the first relevant question is, I mean, what we can do despite the large scale difference, no, we have between what we can do in the lab and what we want to investigate. No? As you can see here, we are talking about 18 orders of magnitude difference. And this is why I will try to show you, I mean, I will try to give you a kind of landscape of what it's been doing concerning accelerator physics here on Earth to contribute, no, to the understanding mostly of the internal structure of neutron stars. So, as experimentalists, maybe the first question will be, I mean, we have also learned, no, in this workshop that probably one of the most relevant degrees of freedom when we want to understand neutron stars is density or pressure. So as experimentalists, maybe the first thing one should wonder is, okay, we know we have to produce very large pressures, no, or matter on the large densities. So which is the highest pressure we can produce in a terrestrial lab? So, and how to produce it on macroscopic matter. Okay, let's start talking on macroscopic matter, because in principle our object is a macroscopic object. So I don't know if any of you have an idea on which is the high pressure we can produce on a lab on Earth and how to do it. No, so if we go to the most recent answer, so the most recent answer comes from just a few months ago. Okay, and this is a paper where some group of scientists, they were able to compress diamond, okay, to a pressure of 2 terapascals, no? 2 terapascals, it's huge pressure, no? It's 10 to the 12 pascals. And to do that, I mean, this is not even, it's not simple. They have to use a huge, they could, what did they use? The technique is use radiation pressure by using high power lasers, okay? And to do that, they use the highest, I mean, the most powerful laser we have on Earth, which is at Lawrence Livermore Laboratory in the US, which is the National Ignition Facility. This is the laser which is also used to investigate fusion reactions, not to produce fusion on Earth. And in this particular, I mean, this laser system, this facility, this is a huge facility. I mean, it's, I mean, I cannot, you cannot see here, but the size of this facility is comparable to 2 football playgrounds together, no? More or less. And here they produce 16. What they did is that they shoot, it's the same that they, what they do to produce fusion. No? They shoot a small piece of diamond with 16 beam lasers with a power of 500 terawatts per square centimeter at the same time, okay, from both sides. Okay, and by doing that, you reach these 2 terapascals. Okay, so you can imagine this is a high pressure. Okay, this is the high pressure. So let's go now to our scale, no? The scale we have been discussing on a neutron star. And we can do some numbers which are really simple, no? I mean, you can calculate the pressure from the surface gravity and the density and the depth in the star. And if you make some these rough estimates, you will see that, yeah, of course, terapascals, we have terapascals, but where do we have terapascals? We have terapascals at a few centimeters from the outer part of the source. So just going in 2 centimeters, you already have the maximum pressure we can produce on Earth. So it means that with macroscopic matter, we can investigate probably only the atmosphere of the of the neutron star, while as soon as we go a little bit in a little bit centimeters, we can forget about macroscopic matter. And then the only possibility we have is to go microscopic. I mean, and the only possibility we have on Earth to produce matter at high densities is at the microscopic level. No? It means reactions between nuclear matter, and the only nuclear matter we can work on Earth are nuclei. No? So we take atomic nuclei and then we shot one on each other. And there, yeah, there we know that we can produce high densities, and densities which are, of course, I mean, we start already from objects having a large density, no, which are nuclei. The typical density of nuclei is the level of 10 to the 14 grams per cubic centimeter. And if we shoot one each other, then you reach densities that could be higher, no, 3-4 times the saturation density. Okay, no? So now it's clear that the only way we have is by using accelerators, no? And this is the motivation. So in this talk, I will just, I will refresh some concepts you have already heard here and during these days, just to put this into context. And then what I will do is then I will try to show you, because I mean, this we have learned, no? I mean, the structure of the neutron star changes a lot because of this huge gradient in density, no? And it's almost impossible to, I mean, to have a, we have to, very often what people does is just cut the star in pieces and try to understand how matter behaves in each of these pieces of matter, no? Because conditions are very different. So what I will try to do is I will follow this ordering of this hierarchy of pieces, no? From the lower pressure to the highest pressure. And I will try to show you few examples of experiments where the people try to get information to characterize the particular types of matter that we have on these different areas, no? Starting from the crust of the star, okay, down to the inner core. Okay. And we see all pieces are important. No? We have just in the previous talk, no? Even if the crust, I mean, of course, this is not up to scale, but this is just cartoon, no? But more or less you can see, no? Even if the crust of the star is not too large, just max 1 kilometer, and from the time of from the point of view of mass, it's negligible. We see, we also know that it has an important implication, no? We have seen, no? For this detection of continuous gravitational waves. I mean, if you observe a deformation, this is from the crust. Whatever you want to learn from the inner part, which is probably most interesting, should go through the crust. And so, I mean, we should understand matter in all the stages of the star. So this is what I will do. So first I will start just refreshing some concepts about matter inside the neutron star. So remember, what we have learned in this course is that, in principle, physics is a priori not too complicated in a first order, no? Because just by using a few assumptions and few physical laws, we can have a good idea of how matter behaves inside the star. And these physical laws, remember, no? This was this equilibrium electrostatic, no? The famous equations, then the state we have discussed a lot, and then the other conditions we also use are beta equilibrium and charge neutrality. Okay, so these are the basic things we use to describe the neutron star. And then the other second thing is, how do we think matter change with density? You know, we have to take into account. And starting from low density and going to higher densities, what we know is that if we start with low density, for sure, as always, no, the first changes will be related more to the Coulomb interaction and atomic physics, okay? And the deeper we go, the higher the pressure, then baryonic matter will enter into. So first thing, when you increase pressure, will be probably ionization. No? I mean, at low pressure, no? If we are in the surface of our neutron star, so what people think is that at the surface, what we have is almost normal matter, but this surface is tiny, no? in length. And probably what we have there is a gas made of the more abundant elements in the universe, which is hydrogen and helium, that probably will behave like an ideal gas. But this is tiny. It's almost nothing. Okay, but then as soon as we increase pressure, there was the first phenomena we could expect is ionization. Okay, that means atoms will ionize. Okay, and then you will produce, you will have a plasma of electrons and ions, as we have in the inner part of normal stars. And this is something we can estimate, and we can make a rough estimate just by comparing the distance between atoms to the size of the atom. Okay, so if we do so, if we make those distances equivalent, we, of course, because the distance between atoms depends on the density, we can estimate roughly which is the density at which we may expect ionization to happen. Okay, so if we do that, you see that, of course, this will depend on the different species, but more or less you see that starting already from very relatively low densities, okay, you can start ionizing hydrogen, helium, and this will happen, you see, centimeters. So we said, no, as soon as we enter centimeters into the star, matter will ionize, okay? And of course, a little bit deeper in case of heavier elements, but you see, maximum meters, okay? So the first layer will be ionized matter, as we have in most of the stars, normal stars, okay? But here, normal star means centimeters, maximum a meter, okay? Then the second effect we may expect is that once we have this plasma of electrons and ions, should be probably the degeneracy of the electron gas, okay? We increase pressure, the kinetic energy of these electrons will increase, okay? And at some point, the quantum effects will be important, okay? And how can we estimate this, okay? We just can compare the Fermi energy of these electrons with the thermal energy, okay? If the thermal energy gains, this is classical gas. If Fermi energy gains, then we start we enter into the quantum world. Okay, so if we equal both quantities, again, since they depend, I mean, the Fermi energy depends on density, we can estimate at which density we expect to have a degenerated electron gas. And of course, this also will depend on the temperature of the star. Our star is relatively cold, but okay, we can take typical temperatures, we see that this degeneracy should happen at some 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6 grams per cubic centimeter, which again, if we translate this in depth in the star, is few meters. Okay, so few meters in, and our electron gas is completely degenerate. It's a quantum system. This is concerning electrons. What will happen with ions? Okay, how ions will behave on these conditions. So for this, what we can do is just compare again, discuss the thermal energy of ions with the Coulomb repulsion between ions, no? Because if we are dominated by thermal energy, we have kind of gas, okay? If we are dominated by the interaction between the constituents, then we go more to a liquid and solid phases, okay? So you can compare these two quantities for the ions, and what you see, for example, in the case of iron 56, is that already at some tens of meters, the iron will behave like a solid. Okay, it means, and this is the picture we have seen also in some previous talks, that the crust is solid. Okay, the crust of the star is solid because we see these ions will form kind of what we call Coulomb solid. So I will come to that. So again, going deeper, next effect, now we move now to the 10 to the 7 grams per cubic centimeter, and there the next effect we expect is neutronization. No? At these densities, we can calculate, but the energy of the electrons will be sufficient to overcome the difference in mass between neutrons and protons, and then electrons will be captured by protons, and they will produce neutrons. No? This is the neutronization of the star. And this, as I said, is, you can estimate, this happens at some 10 to the 7 grams per cubic centimeter. Next effect was neutron drip, no? So it means that the nuclei we have in the star will become more and more neutron rich, in less protons, more neutrons, but they will be bound. But at some moment, the nuclei, they will have so many neutrons that the strong force will not be able to bound those nucleons, those neutrons to the nucleus, and then the nucleons will drift. So we'll have free neutrons we have heard about. And this will start to happen at some 10 to the 11 gram per cubic centimeter. And if we reach saturation density or a bit before saturation density, we learn that at that moment, nuclei will explode, not explode, will decompose. I mean, they will be not bound anymore. And what we will have is a kind of liquid made of neutrons and few protons and electrons. And even if we hold higher in energy, a few times saturation density, we also saw that neutrons and protons may transform into other species, like strange will appear. So we could have hyperons, or I mean, there will be muons, hyperons, and other phases of matter that we expect to have in the most inner part of the star. Okay, so this was my refreshment. And then just concerning the important ingredient, which is the question of the state. It's a question of a state, of course, it depends on where we are in the star, because you remember, if we are in the outer part, we will be dominated by the pressure of the star, of the matter will be dominated by the electron gas. Okay, and there's the question of a state will be dominated, can be described by this degenerate electron gas. But when we really, neutrons will start to drip from nuclei and we'll have this soup of neutrons, then the pressure of neutrons will be the one who will be compensate the gravitational pressure. Then your equation of the state will be a bit different. Okay, and then scenarios. No, we have also learned that there are several scenarios where we could make the neutron star manifest. So the starting from an isolated neutron star, or what we call a non-accreting neutron star. But there are also very frequently stars, neutron stars appear in binary systems, no? And in some of them, the neutron star creates matter from the companion, or we could also have neutron star mergers. We have learned a lot about that. So I will mostly concentrate on the isolated case, no? In the structure of the isolated case. And I will only say a few words about these other two, because I mean, I think it's impossible to cover everything. So let's start from the outer, no? Let's start from the outer part of the star to the inner part. As I said, first atmosphere is almost, let's say, normal matter, high pressure, but hydrogen, helium, gas. I mean, okay, but once we enter really inside, but as we said, no, few centimeters, then matter ionizes, electron degenerates, and ions frozen. Okay, and this is what I said before. No, we can calculate this relation between Coulomb and thermal energy for the ions, and then we obtain that ions behave like a solid, Coulomb solid. It's called. So this means that the structure. I mean. First, you have this helium and hydrogen gas, but then, okay. But the crust will be formed by this crystalline structure, no? Where ions will not move. Okay, so in principle, to understand or to characterize the structure of this crystalline Coulomb crystals, what people does is just to minimize the energy density of these crystals, okay? And the energy density of these crystals is composed, it depends on the energy of the ions, the nuclei, okay? This is, let's say, the mass of the nuclei and how many nuclei do I have in the star, the energy of the electrons, okay? And the energy of the lattice, what do they are, okay? So this was also some. So these are things we calculate. And to calculate, we use this approach. No? What we assume, or the models assume, is that the nuclei occupy fixed positions, and then you have the cloud of electrons, okay, which interact, and you have this, you have to solve this interaction. Okay, and of course, the distances will depend on density. Okay, so here we have the densities. Okay. So if you do so, of course, what you will obtain is that, I mean, as you start to crystallize and you minimize this energy, finally, the main parameter which enter here will be the mass of the ion. So you will obtain that probably the most abundant ion which minimize this energy is iron 56, no? Because iron 56, as you remember, is the nucleus with the highest binding energy, okay? It means the smaller mass per nucleon, okay? So this is why, I mean, people claim that these crystals will be at the beginning made of iron. And then if you calculate also, I mean, this is from atomic physics, no? The energy of the lattice you have here, what people obtain is that the minimum energy is the one which corresponds to a body center cubic lattice. So it means that these crystals will be made of nuclei of iron, which will be positioned, no, here on this cube, no, on the vertex and in the middle. Okay, so this is the structure of this lattice. This is what the models tell us. But then, if you start to increase density, things may change. No, and what things change is that, of course, and the model what does is just minimize this energy according to density. And when you minimize this energy according to density, what we see is that the minimum energy density does not correspond always to iron. It corresponds to iron for the lowest densities. But as soon as you start to increase density, there are other nuclear species which minimize this energy. Okay, and this the parameter, the key parameter is the mass of the nucleus, nothing else. Okay, and we see that as we go down from iron 56, the next minimum. Minimum energy means ground state matter, no? Because we want matter in the ground state. So it will be nickel 62, 64, 68, and then we go to krypton and so on and so forth. Okay. So you see that what dominates are even nuclei, because we know that even nuclei are those which are more bind, and then they have lower mass per energy, you know, because of these even odd effects. And second effect comes from nuclear structure is that the other way we have to minimize the mass of nuclei is when you have nuclei with closed shells, you know, in terms of composition of neutrons and neutrons. But the number of neutrons and protons, they close a quantum shell, you know, then you know that the energy of this nucleus minimizes. And this is why the system or the minimal energy goes from here to this closed shell n equal 50, and then to the following one n equal 82. Okay, because those are nuclei which minimize the energy of the system. Okay, and this is how do we people predict the composition of the crust, no, from the outer part to the inner. I mean, we are talking, you see, of the last few hundred meters, no, inside the crust. Of course, the more density, the more heavier, and the more neutron rich the nuclei. Okay, and this means that at some moment, since the key parameter is the mass, this is the leading parameter. You just need to know the masses of the nuclei, and with the mass of the nuclei, I tell you which ones they will appear in the crust of the star. So I need nuclear masses. The problem is that, of course, at some moment I reach nuclei which are so neutron rich that I don't know them. I mean, I know they should exist, but I was not able to produce them in the lab. No? And then, okay, one could say, okay, let's use nuclear models, no? as the models that Isaac was presenting us, and then let's estimate masses, no, from interactions and many body techniques. So when you do that, this is just an example. This is for cesium isotopes, okay? And you see that for cesium isotopes, those are masses calculated with different interactions. And you see that, okay, there where we have measured masses, interactions, they agree pretty well. So they have a very good, I don't know, predictive. I mean, but as soon as you go to the region, to the more neutron-rich nuclei where we don't have measurements, then you see that the different interactions, they diverge. Okay, so if I really, at the moment, no, because of this uncertainty we have in nuclear interactions, if I really want to know which is the detailed structure of the crust, I need to measure masses of those nuclei, which are complicated nuclei. So first example, no, first experiment. So I need to measure masses. How do I measure masses? So first, what are the masses we know? So this is a card of nuclei. Representing nuclei, no? So this is neutron number, this is proton number, stable nuclei here in black, not so many, principle, the strong force would bind around 6,000 nuclei. From those 6,000 species, we know around 3,000. And even the masses, we have measured masses probably for some less than 2,000 ones, the one we have here. Okay, the problem is now with the neutron star, with the crust, even if we are still close to the surface, we are really dealing with matter which is still in neutron rich. Okay, it's at the limit. So we have to measure masses of where it's neutron rich nuclei. So first thing I have to do is to produce those nuclei. Okay, because on Earth, I only have stable nuclei, mostly stable nuclei. So I have to produce those nuclei. So we have techniques with accelerators to produce those nuclei. Basically, you need powerful accelerators. And then there are two kinds of techniques. I will not enter details, but at the end, you make a reaction with a stable nuclei. You break your nuclei, and you expect that as a result of that reaction, you will have something which will be in balance in terms of neutrons and protons. Okay, and then you make an electromagnetic selection, and then you identify your exotic nuclei, no nuclei very far from stability. So we see that we have quite some number of larger scale facilities worldwide, which are just dedicated to produce nuclei far from stability, okay, for the investigation of this kind of scenario. Then I have to measure the mass of those first that produce the nuclei. Those nuclei are short-lived. Of course, they will live for some of them. For the more exotic I go, the shorter the half-life. So sometimes I'm talking about milliseconds, okay? And I want to measure the mass very accurately. So how do I do? So the most accurate thing we have to measure masses is using what we call ion traps, okay? An ion trap is a device which is small, tiny, means when you compare with our accelerators, which are kilometers, right? Our ion trap is just a cubic centimeter device. Okay, it's something which is like that. Okay, so in this cubic centimeter device, what you do is you trap ions. There are several kinds of traps, but in this case, you trap ions using electromagnetic fields. Okay, the idea is that they combine a magnetic field with a quadrupolar electric field. No, so when you build this small device, when you put the electrodes, you can create a quadrupolar electric field inside. And then, yes, then you need a strong magnetic field. Okay. And yeah, and for this is a strong magnetic field, the order of 7 Teslas, then you need a superconductor magnet. Okay. This is a bit bigger. It's not 1 centimeter, but it's 1 cubic meter. Yeah, you have a superconductor. And then you have your ion trap. So you do your experiment. So you make a reaction, you produce your nuclei, and you insert your nuclei inside this small piece of metals. Now, these are some electrodes there. And there, when you activate the electric quadrupolar field and the magnetic field, the ion will be trapped. Of course, it will not be at rest, it will be moving and doing a very strange movement. Okay. And this movement can be characterized by 3 frequencies, and the combination of some of them corresponds to what we call to the cyclotron frequency. Right. They have a magnetic field. And we know that the cyclotron frequency is related to the mass over charge, the guy who is orbiting there. So this is what people do, is they try to measure this cyclotron frequency. And to do that, it's a bit technical frequency, they couple a radio frequency to this device. And somehow with this radio frequency, they couple these movements. At some moment, they maximize the axial movement. And by doing that, I mean, when the radio frequency coincides with the cyclotron frequency, the axial energy is maximum. And then by measuring that, they can determine the mass very accurately. Okay? This is the most accurate mass measurements we have. And this is just, for example, one example of an experiment which was done just a few years ago at CERN experiment at CERN, where they could measure the mass very accurately of some key nuclei, which are important to understand which was the order, you know, the composition of the crust. Okay? So this is just one example of experiment. So we know how to, I mean, if we measure the masses, we could have a rather clear and precise idea on the composition of on the crust of the neutron star. So what else? If we increase density, what happens is that, neutronization, no? Those nuclei that we have in these crystals, they will become more and more neutron rich, okay? But at some moment, the neutron excess will be so large that the neutrons will not be any more bound by the nucleus and they will trip. So the nuclei, I mean, the electrons will have enough energy to be captured by nuclei, but the minimum energy state will not be a bound nucleus, but a nucleus plus a free neutron. Okay, so we will start to have neutrons around. Okay, and this is something we can also estimate. I mean, by using just a leaky drop model, so we can estimate which is the isospin asymmetry at which we will reach this drip line. So this drip line is this limit we have here on the cart of nuclei. Okay, this is the limit where if I add a neutron, this neutron will not be any more bound. Okay, so if I do that calculation, I mean, I obtain this number, okay, using this leaky drop model parameters. This is the leaky drop formula, the Isaacson formula, that you know. Okay, so I can obtain this isospin limit, and from there I can calculate the corresponding density. I calculate this density. This is around, as I said before, around some 10 to the 11 grams per cubic centimeter. That density, neutrons are not any more bound by nucleons. And if you go to a precise calculation, it's a little bit higher, but okay, is this of this order? The neutrons start to drift from matter. Okay, so then we enter in what we call the inner crust. No, the crust is divided into parts. The outer crust is these Coulomb crystals, okay, and the inner part, we have these Coulomb crystals, but we start to have neutrons around, no, in our star. So we are now in this situation, okay? And this inner crust, it lasts until we reach densities of the order of saturation density, okay, where there nuclei will not exist anymore. Then we will have only nucleons, okay, mostly neutrons. So this is the inner crust, no, this region here. So in this region, I mean, in the outer part, I mean, in the outer crust, the pressure is dominated by the electrons, no, even if you have this crystal structure, electrons are the ones who, I mean, support the gravitational pressure. In the inner crust are also electrons, but there we have this transition, no? Because as soon as we start to have free neutrons, the more and more free neutrons we have and the higher the kinetic energy of these neutrons will be, the pressure will increase, no? And then, for example, at some moment, no, the neutron pressure will take the role of the electrons, and at densities of around 10 to the 13 grams per cubic centimeter, neutron pressure is the responsible to maintain the superstatic equilibrium inside the star. Okay. So what we also know is that we have these free neutrons, but these free neutrons, they start also sometimes to combine, producing, this is purely model calculation. So this is producing these fancy forms, no? This is what models predict. They produce clusters of matter. And this is what the people call the pasta phase. No? So you have these clusters. Okay? And the other thing which is also of interest in this region is that we also know that nucleons, they like to form pairs, okay, because of the nuclear force. So nucleons will not be fully free, but they will couple in pairs. So when matter dissolves, will be dominated by neutrons and few protons, but both neutrons and protons will couple, will pair, and they will form what the people call a superfluid phase, no? Superfluid phase of neutrons, or a superconducting. Those neutrons and protons will be like a superfluid, a superconducting phase. Okay, so and finally, what we tell us about or what is behind these modifications is the equation of the state. Okay, so indeed, if we want to understand the inner part of the crust, what we need to understand is the equation of the state. So the main inputs we need are the equation of the state, and I will show you in a moment, in particularly what this was presenting, no? What we call the symmetry energy. But we also will need to learn about nucleon-nucleon correlations, because nucleon-nucleon correlations will be responsible for this pair phase, no? Nucleons producing pairs. Okay, so just a few words about the equation of a state. You have learned a lot, but if you remember the equation of a state, you can calculate it from starting from microscopic interactions to calculate this energy. And we are interested in the question of state in terms of density and isospin asymmetry. This we have learned. But when you want to compare those model calculations with measurements, for example, or astrophysical observations, very often what we the people does is just to make an approximation. No? They express this energy as a Taylor expansion, no, of different terms depending on density and depending on isospin. Okay, and this is why people talk about isoscalar terms, which are those who depends on that do not depend on the neutron asymmetry or isospin asymmetry, and isovector terms, those who depend on the neutron proton ratio. Okay, so the isoscalar ones we know pretty well because this is symmetric nuclear matter. As normal nuclei we have on Earth, stable nuclei are symmetric. And we are investigating those nuclei since many decades. So we know pretty well how the equation of a state behaves for symmetric nuclear matter, but we have difficulties for the asymmetric ones. Okay, this was already explained, and this is why this symmetry energy is introduced. No, the symmetry energy is nothing else than the difference between the energy of pure neutron matter and symmetric matter. No? And when you go to this equation, are those terms here. So this symmetry energy is nothing else than the energy you need to transfer protons into neutrons. No? If I have symmetric matter, okay, this is a saturation density, and I transfer all of the protons into neutrons, the energy I need is some 30 MeV per nucleon. This we know already from the leaky drop model. Okay? But the most interesting part for neutron stars, of course, is neutron-rich matter, and then is the characterization of this symmetry energy. No? So the idea is, okay, so the idea is, let's see how from the experiments I can characterize at least these three terms in this Taylor expansion. No? Zero order, this is the symmetry energy at saturation density, but most interesting is how this symmetric energy changes with density. No? And this is why we have this slope parameter L and even a screeners parameter. No? Okay, so the idea is to get information on these two parameters and then compare to models, no? To validate models. And we also saw, no, that those this symmetry energy is very important, no, to understand the macroscopic structure of the star, no? Because if the symmetry energy is large, it means pressure will be large, and then the neutron star could be also more massive. Okay? If the symmetry energy is smaller, pressure will be smaller, and the limiting mass, this famous limit we have been discussing on the mass of neutron star, will depend very much on this symmetry energy. Okay, so let's try to obtain information about symmetry energy, so from experiments from the lab. First things, again, masses. We have already talked how to measure masses. Why? Because masses tell us about, we are talking about nuclear matter around saturation density. Masses tell us about the symmetry energy at saturation density. It means that will tell us, it will tell us about this first term that we have here. Okay, and masses, we have measured many masses, okay? And from these measurements, we can determine this symmetry energy and the value which is obtained by doing some really complex procedures is that this symmetry energy saturation takes a value which is between 30.5 31.2 MeV, and they also can extract some value on the slope parameter, but with a larger incertitude. Okay, so this is the results of this feed. So I can, the mass is constrained pretty well the order zero parameter, and a little bit worse, not so well, the first order parameter. Okay, but at least we have some information from masses. Second technique. The second technique was proposed some years ago to investigate now the density dependence, the L parameter, was to measure what we call the neutron skin of the nuclei. So the neutron skin of the nuclei is nothing else than the difference between the radial distribution of neutrons and the radial distribution of protons inside a nucleus, okay? Because we know, I mean, in principle, that neutrons and protons, they are not uniformly distributed, okay? And they are not uniformly distributed because of the symmetry energy. You know? The symmetry energy tends to expel neutrons away and to attract protons. Okay, and this is why inside the nucleus we have the protons, they concentrate more in the inner part and the neutrons more in the outer part. Okay, and this difference, this is what we call the neutron scheme, which is nothing else than the difference between a square radius between neutrons and protons. Okay, it's very sensitive to the symmetry energy. And this was shown, no, by many model calculations, or some by Isaac also, no, that this neutron scheme, if you take whatever interaction, okay, it really correlates very nicely with the value of L. So this means that if I am capable to measure this thickness, this with high precision, automatically I will have L with high precision. So this is the idea. So how do we measure neutron, skins? So to measure neutron skins, I have to measure the proton distributions and nucleus. This is relatively easy because by using an electromagnetic probe, electrons, I scatter electrons on the nucleus, and then I can measure from there the form factor. I can determine the charge distribution inside the nucleus. This is well known, and for stable nuclei, this is relatively easy to measure and accurate. Okay. The problem are neutrons, okay? Because for neutrons, in principle, we need hadronic probes, and hadronic probes are relatively dirty and are not so easy to interpret. So there are several techniques to measure the proton neutron radial distribution, starting from elastic scattering with hadrons. Okay, I use protons, antiprotons, and I will show you a couple of examples of how people does this measurement. So first thing is elastic scattering of protons, and this is a nice experiment. It was done a few years ago in Osaka, where the people took advantage of thin isotopes, because in the thin isotopic chain, you have several stable isotopes. So not only one, but there are several, no? You have here 16, 116, 118, 120, 122, 124. So you are changing the number of neutrons, and you are changing, in principle, the neutron skin thickness there. And they just elastically scatter protons, and just by analyzing the differential cross-section respect to the angle, they could, on some model calculations, some theory model calculations on the reaction against, they could constrain the slow parameter of the energy density. Okay, so this was one interesting result. Another technique is to use what the people call electric dipole polarizability. So this idea consists on introduce a perturbation in a nucleus and electromagnetic perturbation. So if I introduce an electromagnetic perturbation in my nucleus, what we know is that protons and neutrons, they will start to move on opposite phases, okay, because of the electromagnetic interaction. Okay, and this is something we can measure. We can measure the energy of this amplitude, this movement. This is a collective movement in the nucleus. We can measure this, okay, from the energy release. And it was also shown that this is called the dipole polarizability, okay, that the strength of this movement somehow it also correlates very well with the density parameter, no? Because finally it's the symmetry energy who push apart, the electromagnetic push apart neutrons and protons, and the symmetry energy brings them together, no? They restore the, so if you, this is why you also have a very good correlation between this, the strength of this movement, and this is another source of information. And finally, the last example I wanted to tell you in experiments looking to this neutron thickness is a rather important experiment was proposed at GLAB in Virginia, in the US. This is called the parity violating electron scattering. So here the idea was different, because here the idea is to use an electromagnetic probe. Okay, we have said, see, no, with electrons I can check, measure the proton distribution, but they use also electrons to measure neutrons. Why? Because electrons, they can interact with hadrons via the exchange of a photon, no, with protons, okay, what we have been discussing, but they could also interact via the weak interaction by exchanging a C0 boson with neutrons, okay? Because neutrons, they have a rather large, weak charge, okay, but not protons. So it means that an electron interacts with protons electromagnetically, but interacts with neutrons through the weak interaction, okay? And moreover, we know that the weak interaction introduces some parity violating term in the scattering amplitude, Okay, this means that we expect that the scattering will be different according to the density of the electrons. So the idea of this experiment was to use electrons with different density. You polarize, when you accelerate electrons, you polarize them up or down, okay? And then you scatter them on your nucleus. Okay? And then what you look is to, you look to relative cross sections. I look how many of the up minus down respect to the sum of two. No, it means very simple. No, I just look how many of them scatter right, how many of them scatter left. If there is no symmetry breaking, if there is no parity violating, I mean the ratio will be one. Okay, if there is parity violating, we should measure this. And this parity violating term, it really is related to the form factor of the weak interaction with the neutron, and from there we can obtain the density profile of neutrons. So this was claimed to be an experiment, very clean, almost model independent, that should provide a very accurate measurement of the neutron skin thickness for lead-208. Okay? And it was published like that since many years, and they have been working very hard for doing this very accurate experiment. I will come back to the results in a moment. First, I will, and yeah, another technique, just very fast, concerns also using heavy ion collisions. No? You can also make heavy ion collisions, and then the symmetry energy will tend also always to produce ejectile, which are more neutron rich. No? You put more neutrons than plasma, and then by looking to the ratios of different isospin pairs or mirror clusters, no, neutron, protons, tritium, helium 3, lithium 7, beryllium 7, you should observe a difference which is related to, could be related to the symmetry energy. So in this case, a little bit more complex because we have to make transport calculations, and it's not always evident the derivation of this effect. But nevertheless, so here we come to what has been measured, no, the results of the different measurements that have been done to constrain the symmetry energy at densities around saturation, a little bit below, no, with all these different techniques. No? So when people combine all these different techniques, okay, so we observe here the correlation between the two first parameters in the symmetry energy, no? Zero order and first order parameter S and L. And here you have the constraints from the different measurements. No? We have the masses, which were here, we have some. We have the elastic scattering of protons with thin isotopes, heavy ion collisions here, the electric dipole polarizability here, no? And this, with this combined analysis, okay, people arrived to a consensus. I mean, this is the last consensus which was achieved just at the beginning of this year, no? And this consensus also was in agreement with astronomical observations, and with this the people produced what they call these fiducial values, no? Reference values, accepted reference values for these two parameters, and those were the values, no? I mean, the symmetry energy at saturation should be some 31.6 plus minus 2.7 MeV, and the slope parameter should be some 58.9 plus minus 16 MeV. So this was the situation we had the beginning of present year. But a few months ago, GLAB, the Prex experiment, published the results concerning this electron, this pairing violating electron scattering experiment I was mentioning, okay? Which was really expected by the community, no? Everybody was expecting this result because they were claiming this would be the most precise determination of the neutron skin thickness, and they could really constrain the L parameter. And they published this result, this was April this year, I think. And okay, you see here the value for the neutron skin thickness they obtained, it was 0.283 Fermi. So this is the difference between the radial distribution of protons and neutrons, which was already a bit larger or larger than expected. No? And if you now translate this measurement into symmetry energy values, no, you make from calculation and generate this, the situation is this one. Okay, so that this expected very accurate measurement provides a value which is completely, I mean, it's rather out from, it is measured from all other experiments, okay? And this has created a lot of discussions on the community. At the moment, I think you have two or three seminars per day, four or five papers on archives. trying to explain these things. But okay, I cannot comment more than what the authors say in the paper. No, if you read the paper, the interpretation paper, they said they wrote a first paper on the results and a second one on the interpretation. Okay? Also, because the interpretation, yeah, in the interpretation, they compare with other experiments on the lab, but also with astronomic observations. No? And here you have the comparison between, of course, yeah, from this measurement, you can also start to go to a neutron star and extract the radius of the neutron star, okay, and compare also with this tidal deformability. So here you have the results obtained by PREX, and PREX will be this area here, okay, in this curve, okay, this curve. You have the measurements by the constraints we have, no? NICER also constrained the radii, okay? And the constraints given by NICER are this one here, which, okay, this could be acceptable, but no, we are also a bit disappointed by NICER because finally the accuracy is not that, no? It's not that good or extremely good, but okay, it's still. But then there are the tidal deformability measured by gravitational waves. Okay, so what the author says? The author says just what they comment on. The result systematically overestimates current limits based, I mean, not only on experiments, also on models, okay? Because there is no model, I mean, I will not say there is no model, but because you can always find a model who describes this. But accepting models or realistic models, they do not agree with this, okay? So they recognize that there is something strange, but also when they compare with the astronomic observation, they say that the allowed region, I mean, yeah, the allowed region for tidal deformability, in particular when comparing with the gravitational waves, no? With this 1708, 1710 event, no? They say that the allowed region for tidal deformability, they said, falls comfortable within the 800 limit reported in the discovery paper. Discovery paper was the first paper which was published just after the discovery. So I didn't follow in detail this analysis. I'm not a specialist on this, but the other people would tell you. I mean, apparently in this first paper, the upper limit that was obtained for the tidal deformability was 800, okay, here. Okay, if your limit is here, okay, your measurements could be okay. But there was a second revision of this upper limit by the LIGO people. And in this second revision, they reduced this limit to some 500 a.m. Okay, so let's say that, I mean, even, okay, this is a more serious challenge, no? How to put together this measurement with other things. So it's strange. So this is the situation we have at the moment. And just a little like that, and the discussion will continue. Okay. Second important input, so this is concerning the equation of state around saturation densities. Second important input, as I said, is nucleon-nucleon correlations, no? Because nucleon-nucleon correlations are the ones which are responsible for this neutron superfluid that we think we have in the interior of the star, no? Starting from the inner crust and also in the core of the star. And these neutron-neutron pairs, they are there, I mean, we know, I mean, they are there because of the attractive nature of the nuclear force, you know, but also because neutron stars are cold, no? Because, you know, superconductors, you have superconductors at very low temperatures, no? As soon as your temperature increases, the pairs break away, okay? So what I represent, so this we know, and of course, we also have the theory, no? The BCS theory to understand this phenomenon, okay? And when you use BCS theory and then you calculate what the people call the critical temperature for having a superconductor or superfluid, and you see this is for the according to the density, and this will be for the inner crust, and this will be for the core, and you see that these critical temperatures are, let's say, large compared to the temperature of the star. It means that the temperature in the star is sufficiently cold to keep the pairs coupled. Okay, so this is what we expect to have this superconductor. And on top of that, dot CDC comes from theory, okay, from the nuclear interaction and from the BTS theory. And on top of that, we have some indications, no? We have also heard a bit about these glitches phenomena that are observed on neutron stars, no? And the rotation frequency from time to time, it increases, okay? So this is interpreted as a possible coupling between the superfluid phase. The superfluid phase is in the inner part of the star. So you have a smaller moment of inertia, you are rotating faster, okay? While the crust is rotating not so fast. But at some point, there will be some coupling between these movements, and then this part of the angular momentum, which is transferred from the inner part of the crust, and the crust accelerates. Okay, this is as far at least how I understand. And this could be one explanation for these glitches. So these glitches, if this is confirmed, will be they will also confirm the existence of this superfluid inside the star. Okay, then it's important to understand these nucleon-nucleon correlations. Also because, I mean, these nucleon-nucleon correlations are produced by the attractive nature of the nuclear force, but also we know that there are some components of the nuclear force which are short-range. The distance between nucleons could be very small, okay? So if we have, this is what we call short-range correlation. So if we have short-range correlations, means that nucleons, they really approach very closely one to each other, probably 0.5 fermions or a bit less, okay? Automatically, the relative momentum between these two nucleons will be larger than at normal distances. No? The closer I go, the higher the relative momentum, okay? And this may have some implications because what is expected to have is to happen is that this momentum could be larger than the Fermi momentum, okay? For these short-range correlated pairs. So it means if I look to the occupancy of neutrons in my, say, Fermi gas approach, no, according to the momentum, if my neutron gas is degenerated, I should have all the states occupied up to the Fermi level, and then they should drop here, okay? If correlations produce pairs at high momentum, and momentum above the Fermi momentum, it means that I will have nucleons in this region, okay? But most important, I will deplete the region here. And this depletion will have important implications on the cooling mechanism of the star. Remember, having also discussed, this Urca cooling mechanism. Remember the Urca mechanism, you have a neutron, decays into a proton plus electron, antineutrino. And when I have proton electron, the proton captures an electron, I produce a neutron, and I produce a neutrino. And this is okay, recurrent. Okay, it means that every time I have this double process, the nature of this, the composition of the star doesn't change, but we emit a pair of neutrino antineutrino, and this is the cooling mechanism of the star. What happens, no? If my neutron gas is completely degenerate, okay, all states are filled, and Pauli will forbid this decay. So the cooling mechanism will stop, okay? If I have correlations, so range correlations, so range correlations deplete the distribution here, and then I may have neutron decays, and then I may restart the cooling process of the star. Okay, so these correlations play an important role on this. Okay, okay, so how to measure this correlation? So there are a number of experiments which were looking to these correlations in side nucleus, no? Which is the only thing we can investigate. So already in the 80s, there were experiments at NICEF in the Netherlands, okay, who already saw that in fact, some 35-40% of the nucleons, when you just look, do you make a knockout? They use electron scattering, and they knock out protons from nuclei. And what they observe is that when they look to the probability to knock out a proton from a nucleus, the probability that this nucleon occupies a quantum orbit, which is behind the Fermi level, was done by some 35%. Or the other way around. So 35% of the nucleons, of the protons in this case, were not occupying orbitals below Fermi level. Okay, this is in contrast what we know in nuclear physics at the shell model. No, in our shell model, nucleons occupy orbitals starting from the low energy levels up to the Fermi level, or orbitals are occupied and everything is fine. But if I have correlations, no, the correlations we deplete some of these orbitals. And this is what they observe, that 40%, 35-40% of the nucleus, or the way around, 65% of the nucleus were behaving as belonging to shell model orbitals, okay, and the others not. Okay, these investigations will continue more recently in GLAB in the US. And there they do not only measure how many nucleons were or not in standard quantum orbits, but which was the momentum. they measure the momentum of these nucleons. Okay. And what they show is that from this 40%, which is not in classical orbit, no, they are not classical standard orbits, orbitals, 20% they have momentum, a momentum which is above the Fermi momentum, meaning that the population of nucleons which are here is 20%. Okay, so 20% of course those pairs are produced in a stunt, I mean just in a moment. Yeah, use disappear. No? So when you look, you take a picture of your nucleus, you will observe that at that moment, at least 20% of the nucleons are above the Fermi level, and they confirm what we have were saying before. But even more, what they saw is that from this 20% of nucleons, 90% of those nucleons were paired in neutron-proton pairs. So what is dominating is pairs formed by a neutron and a proton, and only 5% is neutron-neutron-proton-proton.
I have one question. Does there exist the possibility to experimentally determine where in the nucleus are these pairs, whether they are more in the outer part or more in the center? Or
they measure the momentum, they measure the center of mass momentum, and where, I don't think they measure where, no? I don't think so.
But it has been interesting information about the structure of big nuclei?
I don't think so. So okay, so we have this short range correlation pair, and this is we understand because those pairs are produced. We know are produced by the tensor force. No? So the tensor force favors the neutron proton interaction. Okay, so this is naturally coming from there. Okay, so we have this, and they also what we did also is that they measured this for different nuclei. No? They measured this for this relative ratio of high momentum protons and neutrons as a function of the isospin asymmetry. No? So they measure this for symmetric nuclear matter, which is here, carbon 12. Okay, but they work with a stable nuclei, but when you are stable and you go very heavy stable nuclei, they have more neutrons than protons. Okay, and this is what they do. And what they observe here is that, in fact, if you have 20% of your nucleons are forming neutron-proton pairs, okay? When I have symmetric matter, I mean, same number of neutrons and protons, the relative number of neutrons and protons in this high momentum tail will be the same, okay? But when I go to neutron-rich, okay, so it means when I move here, for example, lead 208, I have more neutrons than protons. When I take 20% of pairs neutron-proton, when I go relative to neutrons or relative to protons, the amount of protons with high momentum is much larger than the amount of neutrons with high momentum. Just simple numbers, okay? And this is why when you go to what they obtain, no, is that when you go to very neutron-rich matter, the few and few protons you have, they have more and more momentum because they couple with the neutrons. Okay, and this have implications on the equation of a state. Okay, it means that when you go to neutron state, neutron star, where you are dominated by neutrons and you have few protons, if those few protons tend to couple with neutrons, automatically their kinetic energy will increase, and this will affect the equation of a state. No? We were discussing yesterday with Isaac, and what the calculations say that this coupling effect, this orange correlation, should soften the equation of a state. I mean, if this is that much as in this paper, we have some doubts, but there is an effect on the equation of a state because of the presence of these correlations. And now we have experiments measuring this. Good. So let me go to the core, just coming to the approaching the end. Let's go now to the core of the star. No? We have discussed the crust. Let's go to the core. The core, it means we have densities, which are above saturation density. So things became more and more complicated and more uncertain, okay? So what we know now that at above saturation density, nuclei dissolve, okay? We have neutron protons form this superfluid we have been discussing about, and we try to understand these pairs by investigating these nucleon-nucleon correlations, which comes from the strong interaction, okay? If we increase density, those are rough numbers, of course, don't take it as then what happens is that electrons will become ultra-relativistic, no? The more density, the more energy have the electrons. And at some point, the energy of the electrons will be larger than the energy you need to transfer an electron into a proton, a muon. No? Muon is 140 MeV. If your electrons switch this energy, for the system will be more favorable to transfer electrons into muons than to keep putting energy into the electrons. So what we know is that when increasing energy, the first thing will happen is that electrons, you see here, will transfer into muons. No? We will have to we will see how muons appear in our star. But the same, no? If we keep increasing density, at some moment it's energetically more favorable for the system to produce hyperons. So neutrons will transfer into hyperons, no? And then you will have the appearance. This is what the models tell us, that you will have lambdas and cascades and others appearing there. And okay, this complicates a bit some equation of the state, because now, of course, we need to characterize the symmetry energy at suprasaturation density. What I told you until now, we were discussing saturation density or below saturation densities. Okay, now we have to go to densities higher than the one we have in nuclei. We need to investigate neutron-nucleon correlation, we have discussed, but now we need information also on hyperons, hyperon-nucleon interaction, hyperon-hyperon interaction, and moreover, in medium properties of hadrons. No? We know many of these hadrons, we know their properties in free space, but now you have these hadrons in the medium, and this complicates things. So what can we do from the experimentalist point of view? Okay, and then see the okay, also about symmetry, the question of the state. No? I mean, when we go to this high energy, I mean, what I showed you is that we have been able to constrain the symmetry energy around saturation density and below. And there you see that now we know which forces, which interactions reproduce this the question of the state here. But again, when we enter into this new region where very little is known, you see, no, different interactions, they produce different predictions for your equation of the state. And in any case, from the experimental point of view, so there is large uncertainties from the theoretical point of view, and from experiments, the only way we have to reach this region now is collisions, heavy ion collisions at high energies. Okay, but not too high. I mean, you need to compress your nuclei. No, you want to increase density. But not too much, because if you put too much energy, then there is transparency reappears, and then what you do is you increase temperature, but you don't increase energy. No, this is, I don't have here, but you remember this phase diagram has been so many times during the course. No, if you go to LHC energies, you mostly increase temperature, but you don't increase density. While here we want to increase density and not too much temperature. Okay, and if you run transport model calculations, what people obtain is that typically, the optimum situation is at heavy ion collisions at energies of few tens of GeV per nucleon. Okay, there is a situation where you compress the more your nuclei. Okay, but okay, so this is the kind of reactions one needs to investigate. So okay, so if I want to characterize the equation of a state at supersaturation density, I go to heavy ion collisions, energies of tens of GeV, and then I need to identify observables. I really break those nuclei, and I need to identify observables that I can measure, that are sensible to the symmetry energy, not to the equation of the state. And as I said before, the same as has been used at lower densities could be used here as the isospin partners, no? Whether I produce half more neutrons than protons, and then I measure the production ratio between neutrons and protons, helium-3 and tritium. This is one possible observable. Another one is pion and kaon production, because we know that to produce kaons, we need to heat the nucleons and then high energies, and then you produce high densities. And other observables are elliptic flows. It's how many particles are produced out of flame. No? When you have a collision between two nuclei, I look how many particles are produced out of flame. No? This gives us an idea of the compression. No? The more I compress, the more particles will be emitted perpendicular, no, to the reaction. So these are the things. But problem is that the interpretation of these measurements is quite model dependent, no? Because then you need transport models to calculate these collisions. And in these transport models, I mean, you have a number of parameters. And from there, I mean, to obtain the sensitivity to the equation of a state is not straightforward, let's say. Okay? So this is kind of measurements I have. But there were some attempts, and I just showed you here two examples. So the two main results, as far as I know, no, concerning the constraint of the symmetry in a system of such supersaturation density were done at GSI, no, colliding gold and gold nuclei at energies of around 400 mV per nucleon, not too large. The density, maximum density rate reached here is 2 to 3 times, but this is more dependent, okay? And these two experiments, okay, what they did is to measure the elliptic flow, no, how many for neutrons and protons, no? How many neutrons and protons are produced perpendicular to the reaction plane, okay? And they could obtain that this observable is sensitive to different equation of a state, and somehow they could constrain the equation of a state. So as far as I know, those are the main results, and these results are here, no? The first experiment, first data came from the FOPI experiment in yellow. It was done already some 10 years ago, or even more. And more recently, the ASIOS experiment, they could make some more precise measurements and constrain a bit more the equation of a state in this region. Okay, so somehow the situation we have now is somehow described here. So the equation of a state is rather well constrained here, apart from this discussion we had from the PREX experiment. We'll see what happens with that. And above saturation density, we start to have constraints from lab experiments, but also then astrophysical constraints enter into the plane. We have heard this, no, these days that the fact that I observe the maximum mass of the neutron star or the tidal deformability, they are putting also constraints in this equation of the state now. So we are from both sides trying to constrain the equation of the state here. So this is concerning the symmetry energy. And the last point concerns hyperon matter, no, the production of hyperons in intermediate. So what I said is, okay, when we increase density, increasing means density is above saturation density, what happens is that some moment for the system is cheaper, energetically speaking, to produce hyperons, okay, that keep maintaining neutrons at higher and higher energies, okay? And this, you obtain this just by looking to the chemical potential, how much does it cost to produce an hyperon, and how much does it cost to have neutrons, electrons, and neutrinos in my system. And this is what you can calculate according to, as function of density, that what we expect is first the appearance of sigmas, and a little bit higher densities, the appearance of lambdas, okay? And this is what all models predict. I mean, this comes naturally. We only need the masses of these hyperons, and then when you calculate according to the density, this is easy to obtain. Okay, what happens? The problem is that every time you create a new species in your system, in the star does that to save energy. Okay, this is the way to maintain the minimum possible energy. So it means that what the star does is to favor somehow soft equation of a state. Every time I change from one baryon to another to save energy, I softer the equation of state. I decrease the energy of the star. Okay. The problem is that I'm not an expert, but Isaac is here to answer all the questions. He was also solving this. I mean, when you put the hyperons in your star, the equation of a state, it softens so much that then when you go to the maximum mass, if you soften the equation of state, you reduce the mass of the star. This is clear. What happens is that now when you put the hyperons, the stars, they don't reach this 2 solar masses limit, no, we have been discussing again. And this is called the hyperon puzzle, no, which has been discussed since more than 10 years, and he was very actively working on that. So from the experimental, this is a theoretical problem, but from the experimental point of view, I mean, what can we do? I mean, of course, one of the problems that probably, you know, we don't know very well the hyperon-nucleon or hyperon-hyperon interaction, okay, which are of utmost importance to understand this problem. So we can try to provide some inputs, no, to constrain this interaction from experiments. And these people is doing some experiments, quite some, just looking to hyperon matter, no? You produce hyperons and try to constrain or characterize this hyperon-nucleon interaction or hyperon-hyperon. So here you have some examples or different facilities who use different techniques to produce hyperons. Okay, they are quite some number. And then what we would like to measure, I mean, as experimentalists, we also have seen, if you want to constrain your interaction, the most useful information are scattering. No? You make a scattering and you measure the scattering lengths, and this is the way Isaac explained us how do you fix the parameters in your interactions. Okay. But what happens with hyperons? Hyperons are difficult guys, no, because they are short-lived. And when you produce them, they survive for the typical energies, they survive a few centimeters before they decay. So to make a scattering with something which survives a few centimeters is tough, I can tell you. And this is the reason why, even though there are tremendous efforts since the 60s or 50s, to measure scattering of hyperon nucleons, at the moment we have 40, I think it's 40 or less. 40 data points to tell you, no, if we compare with the nucleon-nucleon, for nucleon-nucleon, we have more than 4,000 at energies below 300 meters. So, yeah, we have very few data to adjust this. You know, do you remember, no? Some of these interactions, they have 18 parameters, 20 parameters, and we have too few data, and it's tough. And it's difficult, no? The people try to. So what else we can do? So what else we can do from as experimentalists is, okay, if scattering is tough, let's look to the production of hypernuclei. Let's produce hyperons inside nuclei, and let's measure the binding energy. How the binding energy of this nucleus change when I exchange a nucleon by a hyperon. Okay, and this will tell us about interaction. Okay? So this is done at the moment. So people start to produce hypernuclei, and from the masses, you expect to learn something about interaction. And here you have the nuclear charge now in 3D. No, we have neutrons, protons, and up we have strangers. So at the moment, there are some 38 hypernuclei, which has been produced with one S quark, and three, as far as I know, with two S quarks, which are produced. But there are many experiments now at the moment planning or running to produce hypernuclei and try to help to constrain the hyperon-nucleon interaction. Also, people is even not only masses, they start to do spectroscopy. No? They produce the nuclei in excited state and look into the decays, they can, you know, put more fine constraints on this interaction. And finally, just this is the last experiment I wanted to show you. There is I found a nice experiment which was proposed very recently by the Alice collaboration at CERN. And I found this is probably, I don't know what you think, but this is very, very interesting, no? That using correlations, no? The idea of this experiment.
I did a modeling in any case, because they compare this correlation with the.
Yeah. But okay, the idea is the following, no? Here at CERN, what they do is they do proton-proton collisions at CERN energies, at LHC energies. So there you produce a lot of hadrons, okay? And what they look is to momentum correlation between hadrons. So in particularly in this case, in this data analysis, they look to proton omega and proton sigma correlations. So omegas and sigmas, of course, are reconstructed from the invariant masses, okay? From the many things they measure, okay? And then they look to the relative momentum between protons and omegas and proton and cascades. Okay, and they build what we call a correlation function. Right? This correlation function is nothing else than the ratio between the correlate number of correlated pairs, I mean, how many pairs of protons and omegas I have for a given relative momentum, with respect to uncorrelated events. Uncorrelated events, I mix protons and omegas from different collisions just to make a random noise. Okay, and there you find a correlation function, and this correlation function is related to the interaction. Okay, and just very simple. I mean, what people expect is that if your interaction is attractive, the correlation function should be positive. If the interaction is repulsive, the correlation function will become negative. Okay, and this is what they look, and this is what they measure. Okay, they measure this for proton cascades, proton omegas. Okay, and they found a positive correlation. Okay, it means attractive interaction. Of course, protons and negative omegas, they have positive attractive Coulomb interaction. So let's first, what they did first is just to look which part of this correlation was coming from Coulomb, which is this green curve. So these green curves, they come from Coulomb, okay? And the difference is supposed to come from the strong part of the interaction, okay? And this is what we did. And as you said, no, then you need some model calculation, then you derive some interaction. So up to what point this is, I cannot say, this is you can say.
Well, it depends on, basically you need the model to compute the wave function. That is what you measure.
Yes, this is what we measure, and then you need the model here. Yeah.
Here where you plug this model.
Yeah.
You compare. Yeah. So I think they extract from basically comparing this prediction.
Yes.
That is an interesting.
I mean, it's complicated to work, so it's a possibility. Okay, so with this, I end up with the experiment. Just give me just 2 minutes and I end. So, okay, so I have been talking mostly about isolated Newton stars, non-accretive Newton stars, all these complicated physics, many different measurements we can do on experiments. If now we go to binary systems, we have been someone discussing or neutron star mergers. For example, yesterday Gabriel saw that on top of that, in these cases, you have some particular nucleosynthesis processes, right? This R process, RP process. And of course, to understand these processes, you need also a lot of inputs from nuclear physics. So I have no time to discuss this, I will not discuss it. But just to come to my summary, this is just start my summary that you see there are a large number of facilities, but facilities, large scale facilities, I'm talking about several billion euros facilities, each one, working on providing data to contribute to the neutron star problem. Okay, it's not only that we have a lot of telescopes, interferometers, satellites, and powerful computers, but we also have many accelerators working on this. No, and this is the experiments I have been discussing. They are done all over the world in big facilities, but there are also new facilities which are under construction. And just give me a few seconds to make some publicity. Okay, so this is a picture taken last week from the FAIR facility in Darmstadt. I make publicity because we are working there. Of course, we are proud of that. So this is the new facility that is being built. So this is a powerful heavy ion accelerator aiming at producing collisions at tens of GeV per nucleon to compress matter a lot, but also to produce very exotic nuclear matter, very neutron-rich nuclei, and to investigate many of these properties I have been discussing, no? Production of hyperons, nucleon-nucleon correlations, equation of state, and so on and so forth. And yeah, of course, to do that, all what you want to investigate neutron stars and binary neutron star mergers, what you need is to make reactions with heavy ions. So you need to make these reactions at relativistic energy, high energies, to compress matter. And you need exotic nuclei, not the stable, not symmetric matter. You need a symmetric matter, no, to understand the isospin degrees of freedom. Okay, and this is RRRB. This is R3B. R3B is the experiment where we are working at there. We are building, designing, and yeah, the spokesperson of the experiment is just sitting there. So. So the idea is that with this kind of new facilities, new experiments, so we are going to produce and investigate neutron-rich nuclei or these nuclear-nuclear correlations in detail, in general, the equation of a state, hypernuclei. So, and with this, I just conclusions is that just very fast, okay? So just the final message, I think, is it's a conclusion from this course is that we have seen, no, the investigation of, I mean, neutron stars are complex and fascinating objects, but to understand them, you need a multidisciplinary approach. I mean, you can measure gravitational waves, you can measure X-rays, you can have good theories, but you need to put all this together, okay? So this is a really multidisciplinary approach. Within this multidisciplinary approach, one experimental accelerator physics tries to provide some inputs to constrain models and to understand the stars. And in for us, I mean, the fact that very soon we'll have new facilities, we have new interferometers, we have new detectors, new facilities of exotic nuclei. We think that with this, we could very soon really make a really breakthrough on the investigation of neutron stars in the lab. So with this, I finalize my presentation and I thank you for your attention. So if you have any questions?
Yeah. Oh, sorry.
No, please go ahead.
No.
Okay. Are they they have very short lifetime, so are they in the game or are they stable because of the immature?
You mean in the star?
In the star is different because in the star. Okay, what you have, so in the star you have a dynamic equilibrium, so you put the scatter and they decay continuously, and at the end of the day you have a static composition.
Because for example, the number decay to mostly to proton and pi, so this is the source of the pi in the
star. So they can decay, and this is so that they have a mesonic decay mode, so they decay into neutron pile, and then of course you produce pile, but then at the same time in the star you have the
pions can also produce hyperons.
So this is in the end you have a dynamic, so the reaction holds in the ways in the star.
Okay. Yeah.
And could you please also like number 34?
34.
Yes, for example, here, what you are trying to measure is the ratio between neutrons and protons.
Yes.
Because of they are
perpendicular to the reaction plane.
Because they are isospin.
Yes.
And it's possible to. It's possible to try to do it with lambdas and sigmas because they are also isospin and they.
But the decay?
The lambda decays to the proton and the pion and the sigma to
a lambda. You could do it, but then you need, then there's a problem of accuracy, no? I mean, you can do it, but for this, you need to measure momenta of the final products with resolution of 1%. So this is. Tough. You need very complex detectors. No? You need LHC detectors, no? to do that.
Yeah.
This could be done, okay, but it has not been done so far. What has been also proposed, I mean, I just put here one example. There are other attempts, for example, to use pions. No? How many pi minus pi mass you produce in the reaction? And there were some measurements looking to that. But as far as I understand, the problem is that finally is the model dependent interpretation of these measurements. Okay, that and seems, no, I don't know if you follow this exact, but it seems that pions are even if they are measured, the sensitivity to the symmetry energy is not so clear, or this is more model dependent, no, and people could not obtain conclusions on that. So I think at the moment it's also a problem of identifying an observable which has the sufficient accuracy when filtered by the transport models to tell you something about the equation of state. And this is a continuous discussion on this.
I just asked because of the a proton and a pion, and you know the mass of the model.
Mm.
So maybe you have less background because I suppose that you have a lot of melting components.
Yes.
And the last question, for example, in the lambda target, you say that it's very difficult to.
There are no lambda targets. You cannot make a target.
But you mentioned that.
In fact, I mean, these scattering reactions are very tricky because you don't have a target of hadrons and you don't have beams. So basically, when they produce a gaon beam, you produce a first collision where you produce a lambda, and then it's the second lambda that makes the scattering.
Yes. There's a second step, but for example, in LHCb, you have a lot of hadrons, more than one lambda per ten. And sometimes this lambda interacts with the detector, naturally, with collision with the detector, and then decay.
Yeah, but you have to produce the lambda inside, almost inside the detector. And yes, this is the reason for, I mean, why, if you look to this 40 data, if I'm not mistaken, I think so, most of them, if not all, they are have been measured with emulsions. Okay, so they send the count beam, because all techniques, no, you know, this emulsion, no? They send the count beam to the emulsion. You have all the lambda production in the emulsion and the interaction of the lambda with another proton inside the emulsion. And this is the way how this data were measured. And yeah, I think that you have to put the lambda inside the detector somehow.
I'm studying the decay of the lambda proton, a muon, and other things. And sometimes we see that the lambda interacts with the detector and then decay. So the event of this happening. I don't know, because this happens a lot of times in the detector.
Yeah, but then you see the decay.
Yes.
But you can identify also the momentum of the decay.
Yes, but and the what could be difficult is to know that this lambda interacts physically with the material. You know, but maybe we can estimate it with simulation.
Okay.
My question is why for the resolution of this hyperon puzzle, the details of the hyperon nuclear interactions are so important, because I mean the problem is essentially based on rather generic thermodynamical arguments. So essentially you need the masses or the chemical potentials of the different participants. And so why the details of the interaction can change this picture?
Because the point is that what you need to solve the puzzle is you should have repulsion, so you have to increase the pressure. You need a mechanism to get because the point is that when you have a
new I understand. So the idea is to have you increase the pressure which is produced by the hyperon.
So you cannot
influence the production.
No, it's not the production. No. Hyperons will be there, but how they do interact with the media.
You need additional repulsion forces. Yes. Then you would get something like the Omari repulsion for the nucleons. You want something similar for the atoms. Okay, now I understand. Thanks.
Okay, so I know, I don't know if there is any other question. Yeah. Last one, yes.
And we were saying that this is what the only evidence of the superfluid.
Yes.
They are an evidence of the superfluid inside.
They are, sorry?
An evidence
of
the superfluid inside the inner crust.
No, I don't think there is any evidence.
The glitches and this supported model is, this seems to be more. The one with this more people
agree
that the problem, that could be,
but it's not an evidence. But I mean, I think that's a possible evidence. But for example, during the course, I have asked this question to some of the speakers, and you remember some of them, they did not see so clear this relation between the glitches and the structure of the star. So
there was a paper sometime a couple of 3 years ago on pooling that apparently. They were claiming that there was cooling is something complicated there are some data. It's very difficult to explain all the observable with this single model. And there was a paper from people 3 or 4 years ago where basically they found that the only possible way to explain it more or less well was assuming that the neutron were in superfluid. And they claimed that there was a kind of signature.
And
to know what is inside.
Yeah.
Okay, for instance, there is something I was mentioned this breaking index. So the breaking index is just this exponent. So if you make a model of the pulsar, so the normally the most simple model is this dipole model where basically you have the variation of the frequency specifically proportional to the frequency to power two. And this two is the standard value for the breaking index. So if you observe this one way, but this is not the thing observed, very large variation of this breaking. Okay, this breaking index can be also determined from the measurement of the P and the period and the derivative. More or less, you can make some estimations. And typically, for the standard pulsar, people find something like close to 2, 1 point, whatever. So it seems that this type of model is more or less working, but it's not exactly good. But if you observe some object where you do a very strong variation of a very large variation, very different number for this breaking index, that could be an indication. Well, if it is very large, people is claiming that the only possible way to explain this is that the star is made full of quarks. And this has been sometimes. People say that could be an indication that you have a strange star. Mm-hmm. But at this moment, there is no observation of this kind of thing. So there are things that.
So suggest that.
So typically, if you observe something that is very far from standard prediction, that is probably an indication that the object is met. Typically, or for instance, the mass radius. If you really observe masses, so if you make a, just if you solve the top equation with a strange matter equation, then you don't get this mass. The mass radius relation is not like this, but you have something completely different. And then, of course, if you observe, typically, if you observe an object which is very, very compact, so there's small radius and very large mass, that is probably a strange star. So you have to find something that is not compatible with the standard thing to this thing. But the point is that there are many observables. Which different models give more or less similar things, so it's difficult to say, okay, from this observer, I know that this is objective method, whatever, but this is not the case. Unless you really observe something really far from the standard model prediction.
Okay, so I think
we should. Sorry. If there is an observation of a sub-millisecond pulsar, that so if you have a pulsar that is rotating with a period below a millisecond, that is probably that because no models with hadronic matter is able to support such an object. So to rotate so fast, you have to have at least there are models which only you put really quark matter inside are able to support. So if somebody measures tomorrow a pulsar which is rotating at a period of 2 millisecond values, that is probably that would be an indication that this at least it's not an hadronic star, for instance, these kind of things.
Okay, so I think we should stop here. No, I think I hope the course was of interest for the ones who were here, the ones who were online. I think again, we should thank all the speakers, all the contributors to the course, which really did a very nice presentations, and at least for me was very interesting. I learned a lot. So I think we should thank all of them. And
thank you, Jorge.
So we close here the course. I don't know if you want to say something or.
Well, thank you, because you have invested a lot of work in the organization of the course. And yeah, I think I agree it was very interesting, and I think at least it's a very people here, and I hope also the audience online has learned quite a lot. So, thank you again, the speakers.
Okay.